Okay, today is not about AI. Indeed, this video is about 5 modern Node.js features AI doesn't really know about, or it knows about, but it doesn't use them or bring them up by default, at least in my experience. And you also might not know about them. And indeed, a while back already, I wrote an article about these and more modern Node.js features you might be missing. You will find a link below the video, of course, to read it, but it doesn't hurt to surface the 5 most important ones. And we'll start with watch mode. Let's say you're in a Node.js project. Here's a very simple one, of course. And in there, you write some code. Hello world, what an exciting app. Now, let's say you wanna test this. So of course, you can just run that file, app.js, and you'll see that log in a console. But now let's say you make a change and now you have to run this again. And that's of course not what you wanna do if you're building an app. So what you naturally do is you wanna watch this app for changes and automatically reload this Node.js server to serve the latest version of your app whenever you save changes. Now, historically, you likely use the NodeMon package for that. That is, of course, a package you can still use, but there really isn't a reason to do so. Because since Node.js version 18.11, Node.js has built-in watch mode. So here I'm using Node.js version 25, so far beyond version 18.11, which I need. And with that, if I run node-watch app.js, I enter watch mode. And now if I type something here, change this and save this, you see this restarts automatically and I see the updated output. So that's one package saved, I guess. So watch mode was a nice start, but it gets even better because modern Node.js, especially if you're using version 23 or higher, can even execute TypeScript code without compiling it first. So let's say we want to convert our amazing app here from JavaScript to TypeScript, which we can of course simply do by changing the extension. And now let's say we also want to use a TypeScript feature in there. So we have the username, which is a string, max, and then further down, I set that to menu. Obviously not an exciting app. Obviously we would need a variable here, but you get the point. This here is TypeScript. And with old Node.js, running this code simply would not work because it couldn't execute TypeScript. You therefore might have used dedicated packages that can do that, or you might have compiled that code to JavaScript first. And you can still do that, but let's say we want to greet the user like this now. With modern Node.js, what you can do is you can just run this file like this, and you see it runs without any errors. Because modern Node.js can execute TypeScript files, though what's important to understand is that it's not compiling the TypeScript code to JavaScript for you. Instead, it's doing something which is called type stripping, which means it just ignores these type assignments here and just executes the pure JavaScript code simply because that's faster than compilation. But it also supports advanced TypeScript features like enum. So if I have a role enum here, and then I have my user role of type role where I set the role to admin, and I then console log that user role down there, if I do all that, even code like this, which uses pure TypeScript features, even code like this will work. Or will it? I'm getting an error here. Well, I'm getting an error that this is not supported in strip-only mode. So indeed, it is supported, but only if you add a special flag to your node command, at least at the point of time where I'm recording this with version 25. You need to add the experimental transform types flag. And with that, you can execute that code. As you see, now I get my output here and I just get a warning that this is an experimental feature. Because with this flag set, Node.js will still strip types like this string assignment, but it will transform the TypeScript features that can't just be stripped like an enum to JavaScript code. So it's a mixture of both worlds, so to say. And therefore, this feature of being able to execute TypeScript code with just Node.js is pretty nice. For example, if you're building utility scripts or anything like that where you want full type safety and therefore you want to use TypeScript, but for some reason you don't want to use bun and you don't want to compile the code first, well, you don't. With modern Node.js, you can just execute your TypeScript files just like that with Node.js. Now, another pretty nice use case that you can just do with modern Node.js is using SQLite without installing any extra package. Because did you know that Node.js has built-in SQLite support? Well, maybe you didn't, and your favorite AI probably also didn't. They told you that you need to use packages like better SQLite 3, and there's nothing wrong with packages like this, but you actually don't need them. Because in modern Node.js, and again, here I'm using version 25, you can import from the SQLite package. And from there, you can import a database sync thing, which turns out to be a class. So you can instantiate it with the new keyword and define your SQLite database file you wanna connect to. And just in case you don't know, SQLite is a file-based database, which does not require an extra database server or anything like that. You don't need to install any extra software. You just need code like this, and this file will be created for you, and your data will be stored in that file if you don't have it yet. If you do have it, that existing file will be used and holds all your database data. And with that file set up, you can run commands against it. You can, for example, execute SQL statements with the exec method on that DB handle. And in there, you could create a table, a users table, let's say, and then insert some users. And then for getting the users, you can use prepare and then all to prepare a statement and then execute it. And as you see, I did indeed get some auto-completion support by Cursor here, so AI does know about it. It's just typically not the first thing it reaches for, and it often confuses, at least in my experience, the actual methods you have to use with the built-in SQLite support with methods and approaches that might be used with popular packages like better SQLite 3. But yeah, this code here should just work. So if I execute this file, you see I'm getting my user data printed here. And in my project, I can see that testdb file, which I can inspect thanks to a SQLite extension I installed here in Cursor, which shows me my users table with its schema. And if I click on it, with the data inside of it. So another package saved if you want to use SQLite in your project, which is often a good idea because it's an amazing database. Now, have you ever written code like this in your Node.js applications? You wanted to wait for some reason and you're using async await, so you wrap your set timeout code in a promise to await it. We probably all did. And indeed, AI, at least in my experience again, often does that too. But you don't need to, since Node.js version 15, which was released 5 years ago, there's a better way of doing that. You can just import from node timers slash promises, and in that module you'll find set immediate, set interval, and set timeout functions, which are exactly those functions just as promises. So this would allow you to just await set timeout where you specify your timeout, and then once that expired, the code thereafter will be executed. So it's the same logic, the same thing will happen, it's just better using that built-in promise-based timer. So hopefully, unsurprisingly, if I execute this, we do something, we wait, and we do something else. So if you need to use timers or intervals in a promise-based environment with async await, consider using these built-in functions instead of wrapping that code unnecessarily. Now for the last modern feature I wanted to include here. Have you ever written code like this, or has AI written code like this for you? You were using some environment variable, the S3 bucket variable in this case, which for local development is set up in a .env file, and therefore, of course, you want to expose the environment variables that are set up in that file to your application. So you might be using a package like .env for that, which essentially reads that .env file for you and exposes all the environment variables stored in there as environment variables to the application. We all did, and we don't need to with modern Node.js. I mean, you can still use environment variables, don't get me wrong, but you don't need the .env package. Because with modern Node.js, there is a dash dash env file flag you can pass to the node command, and you can point at the env file you want to load and then execute your code. And that will do exactly the same thing. It will read that file and expose the environment variables to this application so that correctly demo is being logged here in my case, because I'm logging the S3 bucket and it turns out to be demo. And that's therefore another package saved and a far easier setup. And again, as mentioned before with TypeScript, especially if you're, for example, building utilities scripts that you want to execute, you don't need to install a bunch of extra packages to do so. You can write them with TypeScript without compiling the code, and you can use environment variables without bringing in extra packages. And therefore, these are five exciting modern Node.js features you maybe knew about, but maybe you also didn't. Now you do, and now you can use them in your future projects.